and welcome to a very special episode of our series Beating All Odds. In this series, we are profiling leaders who are standing tall and setting up examples for all of us on how to keep the business going in these times of crisis. The leader I'm talking to today has not just kept his routine work going, but he has also recently closed a very big merger with an international player while sitting at home in this lockdown. So with me today is Mr. Pradeep Dwivedi, CEO India, Eros International Media. Welcome to the show, sir.
Thank you so much, Naziri. It's a pleasure to have you and good to see you. I hope you are keeping well in these challenging lockdown times. And thanks so much for having me on the discussion. I just one flag that while we have closed the deal sitting at home, there's actually a lot of work that has gone in the background, including nearly a month that I spent in LA working with our merged partners now in stitching the deal together and ironing out all of the last minute challenges that typically such a merger entails. But it's been an exciting journey and I'm glad to be back with you.
I'm sure a lot of things must have started many months ago. But we said it because for the last 4 weeks now, we are sitting at home. We are all in a lockdown. Right. And we got to know about it during the lockdown. So sure. Tell us more about the deal, sir. Let's start with this merger.
Sure. So it's a very interesting partnership that we have built up. Now, clearly, when you look at, Bollywood and the kind of businesses Bollywood has generated, we have largely been India-focused and very South Asia-focused in terms of the content and in terms of distribution. Even as a studio, if you look at Eros, we have been one of the pioneer studios that has taken Indian content worldwide by setting up offices in UAE, UK, US, Australia, etc., and making sure that Bollywood film entertainment is available all across the world. The next ambition for us really as a company was to build a global studio and a digital media business, which leverages not just our strength from an India perspective, but adds the best of Hollywood into that as well. And really today, if you look at the Indian businesses, there's no Indian studio that has really done any scale level partnership with the US studios. And this is not just a partnership, it's a merger. We are actually going to become a single company called Eros STX Global Corporation as a result of this. As with any merger, there are a lot of things that typically goes into the rationale for why you are doing this merger, right? So we believe that there are 3-4 pegs on which the entire strategy is resting. At the most fundamental level is the culture, right? Because if there is no cultural fit, there's no chemistry. You can have the best of financial reason and the best of strategic and content reasons. But if the culture is not fitting, the merger does not work well. In our case, the promoters, our chairman, Mr. Kishore Lula, and the chairman of STX, Mr. Bob Simmons, have known each other for over a decade. They're really close friends and they have been on certain joint boards, including UCLA, School of Films and Arts boards, etc. So that friendship really culminated in an opportunity to create a global studio in our business. From a strategic rationale standpoint, we really looked at the content story. Now, we look at large India-based movie content. They typically look at US Hollywood-based films content that is there. The idea was to be able to amalgamate and take it to a world stage and create global film production, which is leveraging the best of strength, not just in acting talent, but in terms of direction, photography, music, choreography, so on and so forth. So all of these skills that typically go in the movie production business, we wanted to take it to the global level. And then, of course, post that, there is a technical advantage of getting the best of VFX, etc., also coming in post-production. This merger allows us to create a company, a joint company, that allows a huge market access in India and in US. And because we have built a large partnership in China as well, because of our film distribution, and we have done distribution of quite a few movies, including Bajrangi Bhaijaan, which did extremely well, Andhadhun, which did extremely well, etc. Andhadhun was a distribution in China, and even movies that were distributed by others in China, Dangal, for example, did extremely well there. So there is a demand for Indian movies there, duly subtitled and duly dubbed in Chinese as well. STX, on the other hand, has been looking at co-production in China for a while now. So the two companies put together will create a strategy where we will not only address India and the US, we will address the China market as well. So that's one of the strategic rationale. The second really is the whole financial fit of the two companies. As part of the merger, so we have a particular size and we have grown to a particular level within Eros. STX had its own business that was growing well and putting out some good quality content with marquee stars such as Matthew McConaughey, Jennifer Lopez, Amy Schumer, Anne Hathaway, etc. And what we really want to now do is bring these talents together, and create world-class cinema in a financially sound model. As part of this merger, we are also raising, or we have raised $125 million from a bunch of investors, including some that are existing investors in STX. TPG Capital is there, and Honey Capital is there, Liberty Global is there. And we have also negotiated a line of credit of $350 million from JP Morgan, a bank in the US, for the combined entity. The result of all of that is that all of this cash lying with us, plus the predictable revenue that we have over the next 2 years on the film slate that we have already produced, gives us close to $600 million in cash. You know, translated at today's rate of about 75 rupees to a dollar, we are sitting on close to 4,500 crores of cash that can be deployed effectively towards creating world-class content. Now, imagine a scenario where you have traditional Indian stories, like for example, if you look at the Indian mythology, at least on the Hindu mythology side, there is Ramayana and Mahabharata. Now, Ramayana and Mahabharata tend to get seen in a very, what I would call as a socio-cultural and religious context of India, right? Nobody has really looked at the universal appeal of those stories. However, imagine these stories of ambition, aspiration, jealousy within a family, competition, fights, and harmony, all coming together, but being presented in a global stage in a completely new surreal world with high degree of visual.
Is it just examples that you're sharing? Sorry, I'm interrupting. Yeah. Is it just examples that you're sharing, or you've already co-producing Ramayana and Mahabharata?
Right. So we have actually on our slate looked at a lot of such content. So this is just one example I'm giving. Of the kind of stories that we can do. We have not declared a stated intent of some of these, but these are some of the ideas. So there are Indian stories, there are American stories, there are Chinese stories, and Chinese have a very similar Asian ethos as Indians, right? Yeah. So what we want to really do is make sure that we are taking that ethos and creating world cinema. A great example would be the movie Parasite, which recently won, the Korean movie that won the Oscar Best Film Award, right? It's a Korean movie, shot in Korean entirely, with the Korean cultural context of a family that is economically challenged trying to make its way in the world, and yet the humor and the aspect of that story and the dark humor of that story is such that it has universal appeal. We believe that we can create such winning content from India combined with the Hollywood studio for the world, and that's one of the core strategies driving our business as well.
So much you've planned, such interesting things you shared. And all of this must have been in planning. You just joined a couple of months ago. So, right. Ever since you joined, you must have been planning so much. And in middle of all of this, something like coronavirus strikes. And you are in a lockdown. How much has it slowed down your plans and processes?
Actually, not much. So, if you look at the impact of coronavirus, it has been for the last 4 months. So, I will divide it into two parts. One is the specific reference to this transaction, of this merger that we are doing, and then the larger impact on the industry itself. So obviously the conversation had been going on for 3-4 months, but a little longer than that. But basically it has accelerated when, I have also been brought on board and I've joined along with the management team to work on this deal very closely to make sure that our collective team is able to give the energies, give the right amount of focus in making this deal happen. So notwithstanding Corona, we would have gone ahead with this announcement any which ways. It is just a coincidental fact that we are announcing this in the middle of Corona. If it had not been there, it would have been even a bigger announcement. Now, from an industry perspective, the challenge has been that theaters have all got closed down, right? They're all public venues, and obviously all public venues are closed down. So what we believe is that at the worst case scenario, it might the theatrical impact might be there for a year. At a most conservative scenario, you may have theaters reopening in another 6 months or so. Right? Now, when you look at the film value chain, clearly theatrical distribution is one of the larger sources of revenue, which has now gone completely away. So we are looking at huge uptake in the OTT platform in terms of new subscribers and new content coming in. To an extent, the digital is actually replacing television as the second medium of choice for revenue monetization as well as audience attractiveness. In the earlier legacy scenario, after theatrical distribution, you used to have movie premieres, and then it used to trickle down into digital. And then, there is a long value chain of, let's say, in-flight entertainment, CD, DVDs, local cable operators, etc. But the whole revenue value chain of our business has completely transformed, with digital certainly coming to the forefront. Now, our digital play, which is Eros Now, is an extremely successful one in Indian film entertainment. We have over 188 million registered subscribers, about 27 million paid subscribers, which is literally growing by the month. And what's interesting is that STX on their part do not have an OTT play right now. So all the content that they are producing, we have the opportunity of bringing some of it to Eros Now. Some of it, if we believe we can get better monetization by marketing it to, let's say, an Apple TV or a Netflix, we are not shying away from marketing it there as well. So both the options remain available to us.
You
so
will be selling, you'll be sharing your content with other OTT players as well.
Oh yes, for the right price, we will definitely do that. We will ideally like to keep it at Eros Now itself, but ultimately the call is going to be based on whether we can see better revenue realization by way of new subscribers that we can add by placing that content on Eros Now versus monetizing it well in advance by talking to some of the other OTT players. So we are a studio business, which is its own profit center, which will continue to make superior content, whether it is filmed entertainment and movies, or it is web originals, etc. And while the production is currently halted because of COVID, we believe that in the next couple of months, as situation eases up and health services improve, we will be able to get back to our production slate that we have already identified. We also have a very exciting range of movies that we had planned to come out this year, including, I will not name the titles, but movies featuring Nawazuddin, movies featuring Tapsee Pannu and Rana Daggubati, and they are movies that are completed or nearing completion. So we believe that as and when this is lifted, we will have some really exciting movies coming out in multiple genres, which will appeal to the audience going forward. And with Hollywood partnership, we believe that we can create a premium tier of OTT. So Eros Now is our current OTT. By June, we will also be launching something called as Eros Now Prime, which will be targeted towards the upper demographic. Now there, other than the STX content and the premium content that we have also signed up a partnership with Comcast, NBC Universal, and we will be taking their content.
That will be very exciting. So again, we are doing this more about in relevance to COVID-19. There is a clear increase in consumption patterns, particularly for OTT or movie genre. I mean, all those things that you deliver to us. But there's nothing new on the platter because production has come to a halt. So how are you managing that situation?
So see, what has happened for us is that fortunately for us, while we have had a series of movies that were already there on the platform, we had content that was intended for theatrical distribution, which is ready with us. We will soon be coming out and placing some of that content direct to OTT, which basically means the movie is getting released, but not in the theater, but straight away on the OTT platform. You know, that is the digital vision and digital dream that we have. The second attempt that we are doing is we are refreshing our content with some of the international content. But yes, there is a challenge that beyond a point, your own fresh content inventory, which is work in progress, will dry out and you may have to create new, you know, bank on older content. So two very interesting indications that are coming there. One is that we are seeing that audience is now going beyond the initial banner of movies or content that is placed on an OTT site to dive deeper into the site of layer 2, layer 3 and discover content of various types that they were typically not discovering earlier. Our engagement levels are high, up by about 95 to 100% on our Eros Now platform. And we believe that those engagement levels and increase in subscription will actually continue to prevail even going forward. What is very interesting is that there is an attempt to engage the OTT audience, even in an SVOD format that had not been done before. So if they look at attempts at gamification, you know, creating audience engagement by way of quizzes, etc. So there are a lot of ideas around what we can do with the audience that is stuck at home and keep them entertained and keep them, well, we're not in the news business, but keep them informed of whatever is the latest entertainment content available. It's a challenging phase, I agree, and it's not the most convenient to do it because your technical teams are all spread out, most of the stuff is happening remotely, but it's been exciting as well because in a situation which is of a very bad nature, and obviously our heart goes out to everybody who's been impacted by COVID at a personal level, whether in terms of lockdown or health issues that people have had, it has also transformed the way people look at technology. It has also transformed the way we use some of the tools at our hand, and also efficient use of our time. I mean, look, earlier the amount of time we spent just commuting in from one part of Bombay to another, we are saving, 45 into 2, 1.5 hours a day in just commuting. And we are far more effective, you freshen up, you are in home, safe and sound, and you're able to connect with people. I know it's not the sustainable or the long-term way forward, but at least it's a change and, you have to just sort of roll with the change.
We've also become more self-dependent with less help at home.
Very true. But fortunately for me, at least we've been brought up in a family where we have done everything as a child on our own as well, whether it is bartan dhona, jhadu pocha, washing your own clothes, etc., etc. So there is no aspect of our homework that, needs any additional training, and we cannot claim to be, one of those that find these interesting tasks to do and then you know, photograph yourself with a broom and put it out there. This is stuff that you're expected to do. Of course, you know, at a certain stage of life, you do get accustomed to a certain level of support being there. But ultimately, you know, you have to follow the adage of apna hath Jagannath. You know, you have to make sure that you are able to do all your homework and home stuff on your own, whether it is cooking, cleaning, washing, managing. I think it has brought families together more closer. There's been higher degree of bonding, better appreciation. I think there is also a sense that it has also put some of the families in a stress situation. But those stresses are not a result of COVID itself. It is a result of stresses that may have existed in the past, but because of close confines staying, these, you know, fissures or these breakups or challenges are starting to come to the fore. You know that I work very closely with IAA as well, right? So I'm on the managing committee of International Advertising Association's India chapter. We have taken some of the social causes there and are promoting it aggressively, whether it is around domestic violence, whether it is the need to connect to your seniors and elders who may be, you know, in lockdown in a remote part of the world and staying connected with them. So, for example, my mother, who's almost 70 now, is alone at Chandigarh with just my nephew. So I keep talking to her to make sure that she's engaged and she's not feeling the pressure of staying alone. You know, my sister is a school principal in a uptown Himachal school. She's alone because, you know, as a government officer, she's not allowed to move outside her school and she's missing her son who's in Chandigarh, etc. So, but we're all coping with these situations, right? And there is always, you know, we have to find the silver lining in any cloud that is there. And I guess, you know, that's the situation right now as well.
How are you keeping the morale of your employees high at this time? Because everyone is affected by COVID.
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, it is easy to do employee engagement activities, quote unquote, in, you know, an office environment because you have all the resources at hand. An HR team can be, you know, put to the task of saying you do this, everything, you know, cakes to balloons to celebrations to rewards and recognition. But it is not possible to do so in a situation where everybody is remotely placed, right? So, A, the fundamentals of working with teams does not change. The fundamentals of reward recognition and employee motivation do not change. You have to make sure that employees are, A, given as many tools as possible, whether technically or financially or through medical support, etc., if they need those. You have to make sure that there is constant communication and engagement with the employees and team members by way of talking to them to find out how...
So there is some technical thing. Hello? Hello?
Good morning. And we have a lot of our employees logging in and doing yoga jointly with an instructor that allows them to, you know, just feel part of that. We're all in the one room and we're doing it together. So that builds a lot of good bonding.
Okay. So there seems to be some problem with the internet connection. Sir, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Please go ahead.
Yeah. So, sir, before we close, I want to understand from you, how has this lockdown, you know, you being at home for almost 4 weeks now, has changed you as an individual? If it or as a professional, what kind of impact it has had for you?
I would say the most fundamental change that I would have seen in, because of this period is that I have perhaps gained a deeper sense of respect of the value of time in terms of just taking a breath and, you know, internalizing some of the stresses and work issues that keep coming. Because, you know, in a routine day job between commuting and working in the offices, we tend to get very reactive. You know, we respond to what is coming to us. Our ability to sit back, think and plan typically takes a backseat. And, you know, more often than not in a work environment where you are trying to create large scale transformations, you get such time only on the weekend when you either read a book or watch something that, you know, gives you entertaining content, or even think and, you know, do some personal research that you want to do to figure out the direction of your company, your industry, your business, or any other subject. I think this has allowed us a larger share of time to pursue some of those passions. I have, you know, been fortunate enough to catch up on a lot of movies that I wanted to see that I've not seen in the recent past. So that's been a positive advantage. I've read a couple of books, not too many. But that is something that, you know, always has been a passion for me. I'm hoping that on the other side of this, we will come back recharged, raring to go and, you know, conquer the world as an industry, as a society, as a community much better. And I hope and pray that we come out of this big challenge to the humanity soon enough.
Mr. Dwivedi, thank you so much for speaking to us. We wish you all the best. You have, we really sincerely from our heart wish that this merger gives you amazing results in future, and we get entertained by all the productions that you put together with the with STX Entertainment. And right now we would request you to be at home, stay safe, and take care of your health. Thank you very much for speaking to Exchange for Media.
Thank you, Nazirji. Thank you so much for your wishes. And inshallah, we'll put out some really nice movies when the theaters open up once again. You all stay safe as well. Take care. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. Thanks.